Afternoon, everyone. That's only the second ever time in the bank's history someone's been applauded, Doreen, before you started speaking. The other one being Trevor MacDonald, before Christmas.
Well, of course.
Anyway, listen, welcome, everyone. Fantastic attendance, this very special flagship seminar, and a particularly warm welcome to our very special guest, Baroness Lawrence. It was tragedy that brought Baroness Lawrence to the public's attention more than 25 years ago now, following the death of her son Stephen, aged only 18 at the time. In the period since, Baroness Lawrence has been tireless in her dedication to a great many causes, each of them absolutely crucial for making our society work in ways which are both better and fairer. So a fairer criminal justice system, improving policing practices, an improved awareness, and indeed improved approaches to tackling racism, new avenues for advancing social mobility, improved levels of educational attainment by disadvantaged young people. These are the true legacies of Baroness Lawrence's efforts and initiatives over the past 25 years, and what legacies they are. In recognition of those achievements, Baroness Lawrence was awarded an OBE in 2003 for services to the community, and then in 10 years later, in 2013, was raised to the peerage. Her full title now, I think I'm right in saying, is Baroness Lawrence of Clarendon in the Commonwealth Realm of Jamaica, yeah, which is a fantastic title. It's quite a mouthful, though. So after this opening, I'm going to be calling her Doreen, with her permission, I should say. In 1998, Baroness Lawrence founded the Stephen Lawrence Charitable Trust, which many of you, I imagine, will have heard of. In the period since, that trust has done fantastic work, Doreen, with the BAME community and in issues around mentoring, work experience, and career advice for those in particular from underrepresented or disadvantaged communities. To give just one example, its program have supported young people from unrepresented backgrounds to become architects. Significant because I think being an architect was Stephen's dream job. As another example, the Freshfields Stephen Lawrence Scholarship Scheme supports young men from black or mixed race backgrounds, from less privileged backgrounds, to jobs into the City of London. And I mention that in part because that scholarship scheme is something that I'm thrilled that the bank has been a supporter of over a number of years. Annette is here today as well. There she is. And I'm particularly thrilled, actually, because that gave me the chance to meet some of those scholars over the past few years. And they truly are an inspiration and a fantastic, another fantastic legacy. I could talk for a whole hour about Baroness Lawrence's various awards, but for understandable reasons, won't do so. One of my abiding memories was watching the London 2012 Olympics, with you carrying the flag, and with 80,000 people chanting. We can't quite replicate that today, I'm afraid. But I do think the metaphor was actually a rather apt one, because you have been, for so long, a flag carrier for so many of the biggest issues facing society. In a newspaper article last year, you quoted Stephen in saying, "Do you know what your problem is, Mum? You care too much." Yeah. Doreen, your incredible work demonstrates just how true Stephen's words were. So please join me in welcoming to the bank the amazing Doreen Lawrence.
Thank you.
This is how we'll play. I'll pop some easy questions to Doreen for a few minutes, and then over to you to have your own personal conversation with her. I've been told to say, and if not, if I don't say it, I'll be shot. There's no photographs, no tweeting. And what else, Michelle, we're meant to say people aren't doing? Keep your pass on, otherwise you'll be escorted off the premises forcibly. Other than that, do anything you like. Let me kick off, Doreen. Could you say a word about your early years, your background for us? Growing up in Jamaica, right?
Growing up in Jamaica, yeah. I grew up in Jamaica. I lived with my grandmother. I think hadn't she passed, I probably would never have left Jamaica. I was, even though I was one of many grandchildren, I was the only one that lived with her. And I just remembered her always. I presume, being in the Caribbean, there's mosquitoes and everything, so she'd make sure my legs were covered by making me long dresses and stuff. So there's this protective blanket that she had around me all the time. So when she passed, it's like, I presume you think that your life has ended. I had quite a few aunts, very strict aunts, you know, and I understood, talking to some of them later, that all of them, I think it's about five aunts I had, they all had responsibility for me because my mother wasn't, my mother was here in this country. Mm-hmm. So they all had little responsibility to look after me. So I presume looking back, because I probably was very special that everybody had that little bit to look after, but my grandmother, you know, every time I think about her, I sort of miss that my children didn't get to know her, because mm-hmm. she's one of these, she was very tall. I mean, so looking at me, I'm just 5 foot one, 1.5. And so she must have measured probably about, I don't know, 5'9", 5'10". So she's quite a sort of strong woman, and everybody in the district seems to look to her for advice. I just remember as a child, people just always, she's always talking to somebody. And so that's my memory of her. And then traveling here, I used to hear stories as a child of what this country was like. And, you know, when they talk about a fire, everybody has a fire. So I pictured, like, it's like a dome or something, and a fire in the middle.
Right.
And that was my impression of what this country would be like. Of course, when I arrived, all I can remember is, like, red bricks and chimneys and stuff like that. So, and if you think about houses in the Caribbean, you walk all around the house, and no house is, from what I can remember, no house is sort of joined together. Mm. So coming and seeing that here, and the house that I lived in when I first arrived, it was like a terrace house, but you had a basement and it goes up to an attic. And I think in them, that this was in the 60s, people from the Caribbean or wherever they came from, they would either, they'd rent out all the rooms upon what the family lived in. And that's what, in the house when I arrived. And so we had like the basement area, so we had the whole of the ground floor area, and then everyone else. And as the family grew, then I presume when the tenants moved out, we moved up. To the house. And primary school was in walking distance that I went to. Young children, I remember when they were showing a film of Africa, and I presume the tribe in Africa, the things that they probably do is like, pierce the animal and drink the blood, and they sort of look, is that what you do? He's like, no.
This is when? So you came across when you were, was it nine?
I was like, so this is in the 60s.
Right.
I came over, and I presume they just show films of tribes in Africa. And so I think, like now, nobody probably would ask questions like that because the world has opened up and it's so much different and people travel. I doubt if anybody's traveled that much to know what.
Yeah.
And then that would be just a small area within Africa, because if you think about the continent of Africa, how big that is. Mm. And so people wouldn't even think about that. But at the time, that's what, I mean, your child, that's the sort of question you'd ask because you don't know.
And how did Britain feel? I mean, it must have been so, so different from what you used to at so many levels.
Different completely. And I presume in my class in primary school, I don't remember that many black children
right.
In my primary school. But I think by the time I got to secondary school, it was a lot different because it was a girls' school.
Yeah.
It's a lot more different when I went to secondary school.
Yeah.
So I've always lived in the southeast. So you sort of your rate is just around the area and that. And it's only after I got married I moved out of the area completely. But I always thought the Broccoli, New Cross, and over that side, that's where they lived.
Yeah. And at that stage, if someone had told you, you'd end up in the House of Lords. What you've said?
No, I mean, so well, how would I end up in the House of Lords? I think, you know, your life futures and how things happen. No, I think for me, leaving school, I remember in schools, our teachers are so much different. We, as black girls, we weren't given the opportunity to do O-levels, and very few people did. So it's all CSE. So because by the time you don't get the right grades.
Right.
And I was one of these kids who really loved maths.
Ah.
And I remember one of our tests, I'm saying to my teacher, who came first, miss? And she goes, well, you did, dear. And about three times I asked the question before it actually registered. So maths was something I loved. So of course, when it was time to find a job, because by then I didn't go off to university to start off with. Mm. So I went straight to working in a bank. And you know, you do your maths test, whatever to get. And that is how come I got into working in the bank. It was a clearinghouse, though.
Yeah.
That I worked in.
And just coming back on the House of Lords now, paint us a picture of what it's like. You know.
I think for me, when I first arrived, it was very nerve wracking. I remember I had a mentor, and she would say to me, while you're here in this house, there's no hierarchy, everybody's equal. But you find there's those who are there, they do think there's a hierarchy,
right,
and they're behaving
right
that way. And so I used to, and because of who I am, everybody knew my name.
Mm-hmm.
So I walk in, everybody's very friendly, it doesn't matter what benches they sat on. Everybody's very friendly, welcome me and everything. But as time go on, you realise that welcome is not so much.
Right.
It seems to sort of slip down a little bit. There's an area I went to that you go if you want to put an oral question down. And I decided I wanted to do that. And as I walked around, and apparently the doors open at 2.
Yeah.
And there's a couple of people sitting there already. And not knowing what to do, I walked straight into the room. And the lady said to me, no, you need to wait outside and at 2 o'clock. And so all I said was, who do I follow? Because there's other people there. And this guy said to me, know your place.
Wow.
And I said, I know my place, thank you very much. And he goes, oh, do you mean anything? I go, you did mean something.
Yeah.
Know your place. And there is still that bit that still goes on within there. And I think for me, I speak to everybody.
Mm.
I'm friendly to everybody. And if you're speaking to me, I'm happy to talk to you. But for those who ignore me completely, it's like one peer invited me to come and have tea with him. And I said, why do you? Anyway, he wanted to talk to me about, I think probably setting up a new party because of all the stuff that's going on.
Right.
And after he did all his talk, I said to him, why me? And he goes, because of your name. And I thought, okay, fine. I won't be doing it yet.
Thanks very much.
My name is, I'm not going to give my name. And so there's those sort of thing. But what I do say within the House of Lords and within the Chamber, people work extremely hard. And I think you'll see a lot of things that's happened. If it wasn't for what happens in the Lords,
mm-hmm.
a lot of change would have happened. You know, some of the stuff that we voted against and against the government, that would have, especially around universal credit and stuff like that. So I say people work extremely hard in there. There's very few people that you'll see that just come and sit on the benches and don't do anything.
Yeah.
The majority of people do work.
Yeah.
So I know people think of the House of Lords, you know, we're not elected or all the rest of it. But I believe that, you know, without the House of Lords, I have no idea where the government would be today. Well, you can see where they are now, can't you?
You can see where they are now. I couldn't possibly comment and won't. So I think this year marks the 20th anniversary of the inquiry.
Yes.
Into policing following Stephen's death. And I wanted, Doreen, if I could ask you to say a word or two about the progress you think that's occurred since that inquiry. on whether there's further still to go. Your thoughts 20 years on the progress that's been made.
There's always still more to go. I would say some things. I mean, so we know that laws have changed since the inquiry happened. And also, there's a lady who works as part of security in the Lords. One of the things she said to me, if it wasn't for the inquiry on what you've done, I wouldn't be in this position.
What does she mean by that?
As I think sometimes in certain places, you know, like you see, even when I'm walking through, because I don't wear my pass and stuff, automatically I could be a cleaner, I could be working in the kitchen. And that's where the majority of the black staffs are. That's where they are. Mm. So without anybody seeing my pass, or for those who do recognize that I'm a peer there, I could just be a cleaner. And so she felt that because of the opportunity and how institutional racism had existed before, and since the inquiry, that changed a lot of things. And so she felt that because of all of that, she was in a position that she thought she would never get to.
Right.
So, and as for 20 years on, I've been trying to get some information for myself to know around recruitment and retention within for black officers.
Okay.
And I find that really difficult to get. That's one of the recommendations.
Mm. Yeah.
Because it's like a revolving door for a lot of black officers. They'll come in and they don't stay. Okay, you find a few who have managed to get to command 11 a little bit higher.
Right.
But they never seem to get any much higher than... There was a police officer who was an assistant commissioner. And if I can think of that, she's the only black person I know who had got to that position. So that sort of has not changed much.
And that would be true not to the police force, right? That
across, yeah.
Recruitment, you can make real progress, but retention can be a problem. And seniority is in some ways often the biggest gap at all.
And if staff don't see and can see their reflection as they go around in a certain position, they begin to think, this is not where I should be.
And, you know, truth be told, this place is not where it needs to be either. And we've been very open about the progress. We're making real progress, but we're not where we need to be, whether it's on ethnicity or gender or any other dimension of diversity. What advice might you give to us, Doreen, about how we might continue to make progress towards to a better position than what we're in?
I suppose when it's like... going to university, but everybody who had started off, they have to get this certain qualification in order to get them there in the first place.
Yeah.
And once they're there, rather than you looking at how they retain and get to the 2-1 and the first, something within that bit stops that happening. And I think the same thing happened within employment.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you recruit, but what do you have in place in either to support those individuals?
Yeah. Yeah.
And what do you say, well, if a job's coming up, it's open, it's like even doing your exams. Once upon a time, when the examiner's marking, if they see a name that doesn't, it's a little bit different, so it's not the Harry's or whatever, then they tend not to mark, or they get lower mark or don't pass. But when they introduce just numbers, the examiners have no idea who that individual is.
Mm-hmm.
They're marking on what they can see in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
And that is how come, you know, the attainment and stuff beginning to sort of shift.
Yeah.
And so it's like, as I say, within the bank here, what do you have in place when an employer comes in, a job comes available? How do you support the staff to get to that position?
Yeah.
So unless you're doing something to encourage it,
Or
you're not just looking for the same old, same old.
Yeah.
Because the majority of people will have the qualification to do it,
mm-hmm.
but they're never given the opportunity or the training to do it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So those are the sort of things that needs to happen, needs to make a change, so that people can move up in. You know, they need to see that when they walk in, that their boss is the same as them.
Yeah.
And also the male, you know, the male-dominated part, you don't have female. They say, okay, when a woman comes in, especially within law, that, you know, we won't propose because she's going to go off and have a baby. So what?
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean her brain's gone dead.
Yeah. Well, I hope we're doing at least some of those things, but it's a challenge. It's a challenge everywhere, and certainly one for us as well. I mean, when did the debate start improving around these issues? I mean, I just think back to, was it 93 when Nelson Mandela came to the UK and you met him?
Yeah.
Was that, I mean, that must have been amazing, but that felt like that might have been the points where the conversation about these issues opened up a bit.
It's a pivotal moment, because I think when Stephen died, my question to Peter Bottomley, he was the MP for my area.
Okay.
And the question I asked him was, does the Prime Minister know about my son? And he couldn't answer me.
How interesting. What year was this?
This is 93.
Right. Wow.
He couldn't answer the question. Because as far as I'm concerned, a young person, Stephen, how he was killed, it should made the headline news that everybody would be so outraged. Go right through to the government.
Yeah.
But nobody was interested. And Nelson Mandela meeting with him, and even the individual who we say is responsible for Stephen's death, everybody seems to know that it was them. And information given to the police, they choose not to act on it.
Hmm.
So they miss all this opportunity. And the fact that Mandela was able to say that in South Africa, black lives are cheap, it did not expect it here. And having somebody like him speak out, and by the next day they arrested some of the individuals.
It was the day after.
Mm.
I didn't know that actually. So that really was a signature moment, a pivotal moment in the debate. Now, just last year it was, I think on the 25th anniversary of Stephen's death, that the Prime Minister announced there was going to be in future, starting this year.
Yeah.
A Stephen Lawrence Day,
yeah,
22nd of April.
Yeah.
What have you got planned?
Loads. I think when I always have all these big ideas, like, and I've been, for years I've been talking about having a Stephen Lawrence Day. I wasn't asking for a public holiday, so I just think, no, that's pushing it. But having a Stephen Lawrence Day where everybody can, you know, especially young people. I think young people needs to begin to think about their own self growing up, and think about around diversity in the country that they live in, the people that they see, the people that they work with, they go to school with. And so when I went to meet and said, you know, a Stephen Lawrence Day, and I've spoken to various people before, but they wanted to have it in Black History Month. And that's not where I think it should go. Black History Month, you know, they started with a day, a week, and then it got a month, and then that's it. Mm. I see something where young people within schools and so all the different key stages, different elements of Stephen's life can be taught. Because if you see what's happening on our streets now, we need to start changing young people's mindset and start for them to start looking at each other as rather than them and us to grow up with. And when I mentioned that to her, she was like... And I said, I'm not asking for a holiday, just a legacy that, you know, I said, after 25 years, all the work I've done, all the changes happened in law, and, you know, it should be something that within schools that young people grow up. And on the day of the service, I was having calls from her office because the Windrush had come up.
Mm.
And it's like the Prime Minister don't really want to get seen as tokenism. And I'm going, no, you know. This is what I've worked for. There's nothing to do with the Windrush. I understand the Windrush, but this is something completely... Yeah. And so up until she announced it, I wasn't sure that she would.
Right.
So it was a relief when she did. And since that, we've been working, and we've got somebody looking at all the curriculum, how to get it within the curriculum. So you start from the early years, then you have primary, secondary, and upper secondary and in further and higher education. And linking to that, we've got the Stephen Lawrence Research Centre. That's in De Montfort.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a purpose area. So all of the stuff Stephen grew up in schools, all of those things are there from the court case, it's all there. So it becomes where, as within law, if somebody wants to know where the law was changed, it's all there.
Right.
Looking at the inquiry, it's all there. Looking at Stephen as a young person within secondary school and stuff, it's all there. So it's a resource centre, and the schools can use it around the Steven Lawrence Day.
And this will be digital resources available online?
Eventually will be digital, but at the moment it's hard copies and stuff. You can just go in and...
And what age group are you focusing on, Doreen?
Well, right through from primary, go right up. Okay. You know, because I think Stephen's life touch all different elements.
Yeah.
Because the law is something that's a really big thing.
Yeah.
And most of Imran's files will be there, so they can see all his notes and stuff that he'd gone through.
We'll look forward to seeing that. And not long to wait. Can I ask a bit about, you've led... And I apologise for jumping around, just the time is short. I mean, you've led, initiated so many things, so many movements for change and change for the better. I wonder, just stepping back from that, whether you could share with us any thoughts on how best to initiate and have change take effect. In some ways, we're in the change business as well. And you've shown great leadership and initiative and energy. And what was the key to getting stuff done, so much stuff done, on so many crucial societal issues?
I mean, it depends on where you start from. I think when it started around after Stephen's death, it was more me being really angry about the fact that nobody was interested, because Stephen was a young black boy growing up, so nobody was interested in what happened to him.
Yeah.
So is fighting for those elements to say that he's a young man, he had a future.
Yeah.
And that's what we needed to focus on. And then where the law and the police was concerned, I wanted them to be able to see people as people and not put their colour in front of them. And I remember after the inquiry because before when Steve was killed was more racist murder was happening quite a lot.
Right.
And then I believe that young people felt that they weren't being protected by the police. So hence why I think the knife carrying started, because who's looking after them?
Yeah.
And rather than when those crime was committed, is that the police investigate the murder as the murder and not, but what they did or put it into Trident and called it black on black crime. Hmm. And when I asked the question, how many convictions have you had? They couldn't tell me because they weren't investigating it. It's just put into this area and black on black crime.
Black on black crime?
That's what it was called.
Wow, yeah. Really?
And my thing, a murder is a murder, it's no matter who commits it.
Yeah.
Crime is a crime. And so I've had a lot of arguments around that to think that needs to change. I even mentioned it to the Home Secretary, not this one, Amber Rudd.
Yeah.
And I said to her, had this been a group of young white men were being killed on our streets, as a country, the government, society, nobody would sit back and allow that to happen. You'd do something about it.
Yeah.
And she said to me, that's not true. In reality, it is true.
Right. Still true?
It is still true.
Right.
I intend to ask a question about that in the chamber when I get all these other things done. Yeah, because, okay, so I've got a voice and I try to use it in a way that is really positive. And I'm not saying that I'm right in everything that I do, because I don't think that I am. But there's certain things that I just feel that you just need to raise the issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I think once you raise the issue, not everybody's going to agree with you, but there are some that who will.
Yeah.
And for me, it's always truth and honesty.
Yeah.
I don't pretend to be something that I'm not. I don't know how to anyway, even if I tried. So it's just to be myself, and that's all I can be. And so I will challenge anybody if I believe that there's something that's not right.
And and you speaking about it so powerfully, sometimes with a bit of anger, can change the terms of debate. I mean, that's what you've done on a number of issues, changing the terms of a debate around an issue.
Yes.
What's next? What are you going to change the terms of the debate around next, Doreen?
I said after 25 years, the service is the last thing I'm going to do, because I just feel I just need to sit back and keep quiet now. And then the Steve Lawrence days come up, and that's another work in itself. I suppose I didn't realise how much work that would be involved in trying to get that off the ground. But I think it's all positive things that I'm doing. I'm trying to open up where people can have an open debate and talk about issues, or, you know, just be themselves. Because sometimes that's all young people need to be. And half the time they're not given the opportunity, or the negative stuff. When kids do really well, do you see it in the newspaper? No, you don't see it.
No.
You don't see kids going off to universities, they've gone to Oxford or Cambridge or wherever they've gone. You don't see those positive image of those kids. All you ever see is all the negative stuff, and that's what I like to see us change.
And what would you do to paint a different picture of young people doing well? How can we do that in the media, or through politicians, or how do we get there?
I think what the Trust is doing is one way you can see. So we've got students who study architecture who are running their own practice.
Mm-hmm.
And there's enough of those to see.
Yeah.
You know, you've only got to go around and speak to them. And so we had three beneficiaries. One was from law, one from architecture, and one from journalism, where the Trust has supported. And those are all positive things.
Yeah.
And I think that's what media needs to pick up on and just keep showing. And kids themselves will see those things and want to make themselves change. They'll want to be part of that.
Yeah.
As long as we can sort of show them that this is where you can get to.
And are there enough role models, whether it's in the House of Lords or the House of Commons or on TV or in the judiciary? Are we still
So that's changing now, though, isn't it? That's changing. But as I said, they're not visible enough. That's what it is. We just need to make sure that they're visible. Want to see all of that. There is enough. I mean, the House of Lords, you don't have that many.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have that many. House of Commons, yes.
Yeah.
You do have that. You know, so they just need to be visible.
I'm going to pass across to the audience in a second, but one last question while you're all thinking of yours. From your long list, and it really is a long list, of achievements, Doreen, is the one that stands out that you think, of all of this stuff, that's the one about which I'm really proudest? That's the place where I really change the terms of debate, or change the law, or change how the UK thinks about things?
Oh, gosh. I remember when I was... they'd do all the gown stuff and be Chancellor. I remember standing there thinking, as they were reading out all of this stuff, if my grandmother could see me now.
Mm-hmm. This is Chancellor of De Montfort University. This is not of the Exchequer. I haven't missed something.
No, definitely not.
Not yet. Not yet, Doreen, is the
answer. University of De Montfort.
Brilliant. Let's pass across, because I'm sure there are loads of questions out there in the audience. So who would like to be first in asking Doreen a question? You have to wait for the mic. We'll start here.
Well, hi, Doreen. I'm Patrick Vernon. I'm with my colleague, Sahara, another colleague, Penn, and Omar at the back. I'm wearing a T-shirt, by the way. It's called Banknotes of Colour. So for the last 400 years, the bank have been producing a whole range of denominations, £5 notes, £10 notes, £20 notes, and £50 notes. So the question to you, Doreen, if you had a choice, and you said, spoke to the bank, the governor of the Bank of England and to the chief economist, you had the opportunity of choosing a person of colour, because there isn't one currently in any banknote in Britain, who would you choose on the banknote to represent diversity, young people, contribution, and recognise that 14% of the population of this country is of a black and non-ethnic community. Who would you choose to be on the banknotes, which could be circulated around the country, and we could look at our cappuccinos and train tickets?
Our nearest one is probably going to be Mary Seacole then, as if he's talking about this country. Because if you're thinking about across wherever, I would say Barack Obama or even Nelson Mandela. But I think for this country would be Mary Seacole.
So, there's many round of applause, thank you. We can't have Barack. You have to be dead to be on it.
Oh, really? Oh, okay. Okay. Well, Mary Seacole. Definitely Mary Seacole.
Thank you for your question. Let's go perhaps here next.
Thank you for very insightful delivery. And My name is Sadat, and I'm a Stephen Lawrence scholar. And I'd like to ask you, based on the work you've done so far on improving social mobility, how soon are we to seeing a black prime minister?
Gosh.
That's a good question.
But you see, you have to be, I don't know, it's like when Barack became president of America, I thought never in my lifetime. Mm. And I remember getting on a plane to go to America in time for his inauguration. It just, I needed to be in the country because it's not something I expected to see. In this country, I really don't know. I think there is so much, there are some positive, but not enough of our people who are there who, because I think as soon as they raise their head, they get knocked down for whatever it is. Either it's like that MP who's been, which is so stupid of her, lying about the speed that she was doing and not taking responsibility. You know, we need to take responsibility for ourselves. I don't know. I don't really see anybody.
Well, let me give you a name. What about you? What do you think, Doreen? You could do that job.
No, somebody said to me once about me either running for as a councillor or as an MP, and one of the things I just said, I couldn't lie. I'm sorry. Because as a politician, when you're out there saying, I could be your MP or do this, this and that, and when you get into there, you don't do any of that.
Is that a no then?
No.
You're not ruling it out. You just.
No, I'm definitely ruling it out.
You're ruling it out. Just to be clear. Let's go here. The front. Let's go here, around here.
I'm very nearby. Yeah. Thank you very much, and a very warm welcome to see you, Doreen. I don't know if I have a question or I want to answer to something, but I like the question that just asked. And I want to thank you, Doreen, for sharing so much with us over the years. And you, Doreen knows me personally. Thank you. And I want to look at it, the question about a politician. I think there's so much potential in so many of us. And it's just for us. Doreen is right. We don't know who that person is yet. But there is so much within us and within our community. And some of us, we must stand up and we must claim that victory. How do we start? Is by getting involved in politics and playing a part. I'm the chair for a political party and was a candidate in the last election. And believe you me, I'm so determined. If elected, I will never tell lies, Doreen. And because I love my people, my community, and my country so much, my determination would always be to exert honesty and to serve and to serve to the best of my ability. I'm British born. I was brought up in Jamaica, went to school in Jamaica. And believe you me, my desire is to bring about change in this country. And don't be surprised if one day I am your first black prime minister.
Hard to follow that, I'd say.
I'm just trying to remember the face. Hello, Doreen. Thank you so much for coming here today. And I feel really proud to see you sitting here. I thought I knew a lot about you, but I've even learned much more today and the things that you've achieved. We actually met some time ago. It was either at the African Caribbean Leukemia Trust or it was at the Black Women, European Women's Business Owners. We spoke at some length, and it's true, you are friendly to everybody, and you give them your time as if they're the only ones that you've got to speak to, and I really appreciate for the time that you spent speaking to me when you did. I remember the very first Stephen Lawrence march. I was on it. It was within days after he died. Bexley Heath, somewhere we're there, and I remember very much, and since then it has touched my heart, and I've tried to follow anything that I see as much as possible to do with Stephen Lawrence and yourself in terms of what you've achieved. What I wanted to ask you was, you've achieved so much, and there are other people who have lost their sons who have not managed to do what you have done. You've left a legacy. Everybody knows the name of Stephen Lawrence. When I asked my daughter, she said, "Mummy, of course I know Stephen Lawrence. Of course I know exactly what happened." She's 10 years old. You really have done so much. What I'd like to find out from you is, what do you think there is in you, either your background from the start, something about your personality, that meant you continue to be a fighter, and after all this time, and not just fight, but achieve against all odds. What is there? Are you aware of what it could be?
I'm not certain about that. Perhaps because of who I am as an individual. I think when Stephen died, one of the things I remember saying to police officers, my dad was really determined. I did say that whenever you remember, you will always remember Stephen's name. For his funeral, because he had two funerals, has one here and one in Jamaica, so he's buried in Jamaica. I said I wanted, from where my house was to the church, that we're going to walk. And so all the roads were closed, and I didn't ask permission. I just told them that's what's going to happen. And yes, and what could they do? So I suppose there's something in me, and as I said, it goes back to honesty and to be who I am. Truth means a lot to me. And police officers, I think, and also they had this thing to try to differentiate us and say things like, we've never met anybody like you before, or you're so different from other families. And so automatically they want to put this thing in your head that you're different. And I wouldn't have that. Mm-hmm. I said, no, there's millions of people like me, mm-hmm. except that not everybody can. I won't say every day I'm up there fighting, because it was never like that. There are times, every time something comes up and I needed to address it, I did. You know, and there are times, I mean, so if you look now, anything happens in the paper, you very rarely see me, because I'm not, I don't have to. People said, oh, when that last individual was sentenced for drugs, I've got nothing to say. He's not been sentenced because he murdered Stephen. He's been sentenced for drugs. Not because he's linked to Stephen's name. What I need to be saying something. And so they're always trying to put you up, and it's how do you handle yourself in that. I do feel for other parents that at the time when their child had been killed or whatever, they don't have the energy. But I think it's because of how I was treated by the police that made me feel that I'm not having it. My son was important. I'm not having you talk to me in any way. And I was never rude. I've never disrespect them. So nobody can ever say, every time we speak to her, this is how she behave. And that is what they couldn't understand. And that's why they're trying to set me apart from everybody. No, we're all, you know, there's loads of parents like me, except they don't get the opportunity to be, or they haven't got it in them to do that. But I just couldn't allow them to forget about my son. And here am I doing the legacy now. So his name is going to live on.
Yes.
But you having done it makes it easier for the next person to do it as well.
Yes.
To speak up. I think that is the... Let's... who wants to go next, just here?
Hello, good afternoon, Doreen. Throughout your journey through the Stephen Lawrence case, there were a number of laws that were changed. Is there any one particular law that was significant to you that you fought for and decided that, yes, this needs to be changed? And when it was, did it have the impact that you thought it would?
That would be the double jeopardy. Because I think that was done in 2005. And, you know, I've always said that whatever I've done over the years has never benefited me personally or my children or my family. I think that's the only one that did. Because when those individual, the three, the judge could have said, throw the case out, no case to answer, but he made, it's like he was making a statement that they should be found not guilty. That means you could never charge them. Doesn't matter if they confess. And I've always said that they brought that judge in specifically for that. I've never heard his name, Judge Curtis. I've never heard his name again. They brought him in specifically. So you spent the whole of the first 2 weeks legal arguments. So occasionally they may have a witness in, but nothing substantial ever came out of it. And I remember Michael Mansell saying to me, almost been the day before, that this is what he's going to do, but not realizing it's going to be a not guilty verdict. And so having the change in the double jeopardy has allowed, otherwise one of those individuals could have been charged again. Dobson, he could never have been charged. But having that, that made an impact, that change stuff. That so at least Stephen's, one of Stephen's killers, or two of them, could be sentenced. That's the only thing I could say that really benefited me.
Thank you. Where should we go next? Let's go have you over here.
Well, first, thanks a lot for your very interesting and inspiring take. I'm also a Stephen Lawrence scholar with Freshfields. My question is, how do you think big companies like in the city or in the judiciary can show young black children, or well, young children mainly from BAME backgrounds, that this type of life, this type of work is achievable for them?
I think it's opening up for their work experience, and bring young people in, even visiting schools, talking about their profession, that they can do that. Because sometimes, as you, it's like architecture. A lot of young people have no idea what architecture is about. And so when we, when Stephen wanted to be one, it's like, where do we start from? Luckily, people who we've known was able to give Stephen, so he did his work experience in their practice. And so it's by learning, because I mean, it's something that he wanted to, not that I knew anything about it. Okay, over the years, I've learned quite a lot about architecture. But at the time, but unless you bring young people into the organisation and give them those internship and... Yeah. You know, otherwise, how do they know?
Yeah.
And you go into schools and talk to young people.
Well, and certainly here we've tried to do just that, Doreen, actually. I mean, both speaking in schools, he spoke in almost 300 last year, and an increasingly work experience as well. We have our own Afro-Caribbean scholarship program, actually, which involves some work experience here at the bank, which... well, it's been incredible, because people just coming into the building...
Yeah.
And say, wow, everyone here is, you know, relatively normal. You know, some of them. Some of them are relatively normal. Where should we go next? Over this side. Let's go here. Thank you.
How do you feel now about the direction of travel on these issues? Do you feel optimistic? We're moving in the right direction.
Sometimes I do, but sometimes I just feel as if we're going backwards. I suppose you take the police service for, you know, how far have they moved on? I have no idea, because and unless you start talking to officers and things, I have to get from their perspective. And how does the young people view them on the streets? I don't think that's changed very much, because you still see, if it's one young black guy, you see about six officers around them. You don't need that many. One of them, you'd be just fine. And they have this impression, especially for young kids, that they're aggressive. And not necessarily. They may be boisterous and laughing or whatever. It doesn't mean that they're aggressive.
Yeah.
You know, so sometimes I feel that things have moved on, and another time I think, oh no, but then you always have to look at the positive side. If you don't look at the positive and always look at the negative, then things will never change. So you always have to give some credit to where you see things have moved. And I think schools are trying to do a lot more than they did when I was growing up.
And the debate about these issues is...
Yes.
I mean, it's happening, it's open. I mean, it strikes me... As you say, we're going in the right direction, if not necessarily at the right speed. Would that be a fair way of putting things?
Because I've been invited to Cambridge to the debating society and stuff like that. So they begin to sort of open up, but not enough. And one of the things I was looking at when I was growing up, I used to see loads of names of people within the black community who were doing activism, doing things. And when I think about now, where are we? Don't seem to have that many people anymore. And hence why I think people keep looking to me, I'm just one person, please. But, you know, we need to be out a bit more. We need to be taking control, and making sure we're more visible, because there's a lot of things are happening, but people don't know about it. We don't know mm-hmm. the people in the community centres or in the community what they're doing. So we just need to put our head up a little bit more so other people can see.
Very good.
Can I, sorry, cheekily, Andy, can I ask you a question kind of related to that? So I know that here at the bank, we track BAME recruitment, but the point that Doreen raised, I thought was really interesting around retention and job tenure. So do we track that, whether we retain our BAME employees and move them up through the system?
That's a question to me. Mm. We do. This is our own internal network, which Rotidzo is a co-chair of, and Alida and Angelique might be here as well. We do. It's just the story that Doreen said, at the point of entry, we do okay. But it's what happens when people are here that really matters, which goes to the retention issue, it goes to the performance issue, it goes to people quitting. Yeah.
And the support that you give them other two.
And the support. I think your point about it, crucial is the support once people are here. There's enough, when I look through the exit interviews from the people who may have left, it's what's said, it's that there aren't enough people who are like me. Mm. And that's not even necessarily a race issue. It's broader than that often, but we do, but further to go. We had, Gareth.
Hi, Doreen. You say you're just one person. I'm not sure just is the right word, but you are one person. What can the rest of us as individuals do to change that?
Great question.
I think speak up when you see something happen around you. I think many times people just sort of something happening rather than saying, oh, well, I disagree with that. You just need to speak up about it and encourage. So if you can see within your department, and if you see somebody you could help to get to the next level. And I know in the Home Office at one time, there was one guy who was in a senior position as an Asian guy. And what he would start doing is putting people's name forward because they had different grades, and just give them the opportunity and give them the support that will help them to get to the grade. Because if you don't do that, then they will never ever get to that grade.
Yeah. Yeah. Same.
Thank you so much for coming. You said that you're not that different, and I'd like to understand one thing. If you could, where you're certainly different from everyone I've ever met, which is that I understand that there are a number of exceptional individuals who could have responded to the situation you faced and invested their lives changing things and really seeking to make the world better. But what it seems to me that you've done uniquely is to do that positively. And I wonder if you could enlighten us a little bit to help us understand how, and you've mentioned it so many times today, that staying positive and not being negative is so important. How on earth have you managed that?
Gosh. I don't know, I think that because I wanted something positive. I think where Stephen, what had happened to him, he did not deserve what happened because he was a decent young man growing up, and he had that thing around him. I remember somebody coming to the house and saying to me, and I thought because they knew me, coming to see me, and it's because of how Stephen was within school. Like, you get primary, moving up into secondary school, and your first week can be a nightmare. And he was able to put those kids at ease, and I would never have known about that. Because he's not something he would brag about or tell me, or I did this today or whatever. He would never say anything. Mm. And so I think it's a positive thing. I just think if I hadn't done that, then one, we would never have got anywhere. I just think the police believe that you as a black person, you are aggressive, and they have this image of who they think you are. And I wasn't going to change myself to please them. I am who I am, and aggressiveness is not me. Growing up, you know, in my family, come from the Caribbean, a lot of stuff I've never really seen. I don't experience that. Having my neighbor, I remember even now my neighbor, we still speak. When we moved into our area, Marion, her children and my children were roughly the same age. She had a key to my house. And I wouldn't think anything of it. She's a white family. And I wouldn't think, oh, I can't give her the key to my house because, you know, that never came into it. The kids got on, they played together. We went out on trips together. And so my life, I never experienced what probably a lot of people have experienced growing up. I never had that experience. So I couldn't be anything else but being, if that makes sense. You know, I'm not saying I'm unique or, you know, I'm privileged. I don't think I'm any of those things. But I never experienced, and I think young girls growing up as well don't have the same experience as young black boys growing up. They don't have the same experience. You know, we don't attract the amount of attention from the police and, you know, mm-hmm. we don't do that. And so I've never had anything really bad. So this is the first thing that's ever really bad has ever happened to me. Mm-hmm. And I was shot because I believe that society would be shot. I believe that the police would be shot.
Yeah, and they
that they And no, they weren't. It's like the run of the mill. And that was my wake-up call,
yeah.
that I'm living in a society, in a world, that this is what happens to people of colour that I've never experienced before.
Amazing. There's time for one last question, because we're into overtime. And Ritizzo.
Hi. Hi, Doreen. Sorry. Just expanding on what you just said there. So I have a son. He's a beautiful boy. He's 4 years old. And I just thought what you just said just struck a chord with me. And I just wondered, is there anything that you, what advice would you give to a mother like, because I am scared for him. We live in inner city London and I see what's going on and, you know, around me in my neighborhood. And I just wonder, you know, if there's any advice that you could give to any mother who, you know, might not have the advantages that my son might have growing up. What advice would you give them?
I think like you, because I've got grandsons and I worry about them because they're 8. I was thinking a few years time they'll be going off to secondary school, so they'll be out on their own.
Mm.
And so I'm worried about them. I don't know. I think as a family, I mean, it's to instill with them the right and wrong. And I think if we all to do that with our kids and to have that respect and tolerance. And I know a lot of parents, it doesn't even enter onto their radar. Kids should just grow up. But I think those are sort of discussions that you have at home with your children. You talk about all sorts of things they see on TV. There's something happened like when Stephen was, do you remember, he was still at primary school, and he came home telling me, because my children always, I always said to them, you know, you can speak and tell me anything you like. Mm. I may not agree with you, but you can talk to me about anything. And he came home talking to me about this girl, what she was allowing boys to do to her. And this is primary school. And I thought, and I said to him, what do you think about that? And he goes, it's nasty, Mum. And I thought, I don't need to say anything more. Because in his own mind, he's beginning to start thinking about the right and wrong of things.
Yeah.
But if he said something else to me, then I would
yeah.
have to say something. But the minute he could tell me that he thought it was wrong, that was all. I did not need to tell him anything else. So I think as kids are growing, you just need to have the conversation. You're open, dinner time around the table, wherever you're watching something on TV. You know, you have this dialogue with them. You talk to them all the time. Because I think if we don't do that to our kids and spend time listening to them as well, because you have to listen. Because, you know, as parents and as adults, we're always quick to tell you what to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we need to listen to them. And take advice from them at times.
Wise words. We should probably draw things to a halt. Thank you all for coming along. Amazing attendance. There is a reception just downstairs, and Doreen's going to be around. Kindly of you to stick around for a while and have a drink. I'm sure many of you want to chat, follow-up chat with Doreen down there. All encouraged to attend.
Doreen, you mentioned you're 25 years in to campaigning, that last year you said maybe it's time to, I don't know, slow down or move on, draw a line. I mean, far be it from me, or indeed the Bank of England, to offer any advice, but please don't. You have been an absolute inspiration to everyone in this room for the past 25 years. You've been a real inspiration to all of us here today. And I fully expect you're going to continue being a real inspiration for the next 25 years. So on behalf of everyone here, everyone at the bank, please join me in thanking in the usual way the incredible Doreen Lawrence.